does research work, and I remember with gratitude the people who helped me to make this event a success. And the topic is the integration of Buddhist concept of mindfulness into counselling. When you see this word, mindfulness, what comes to your mind? Let's be mindful about mindfulness for a few minutes. It's about attention, it's about paying attention, it's about awareness, it's about consciousness, something like that. So we'll look at how what we have done in the world about mindfulness. Actually, it is considered as the third wave of cognitive behavioral therapies. And I can remember the giant who really contributed in this field, like Dr. Kabat Singh and Professor Mark Williams in UK and Professor Theo Noy in Australia. And Dr. Kabat Singh has formulated a definition for mindfulness as a paying attention in a particular way on purpose in the present moment and non-judgmentally. So that is a widely accepted definition so far. It's a non-judgmental attitude. And mindfulness is an emerging field, as I showed you earlier, and number of studies and therapeutic intervention have been conducted in the world. And when you look at this graph, you can see a tremendous increase, you know, over the years. In 2015, we find 674 published articles, you know, in this field. So it's really increasing. The mindfulness interface interventions, MBIs, and found very efficacious in terms of in the treatment aspects. And the modern concept of mindfulness, and Dr. Kabat Singh says that he has taken this very idea from Buddhism, the roots in the Buddhism. And I found a lot of articles, you know, when I had my literature review, found a lot of articles in this field, and I have mentioned some of those pertaining to my research, done about mindfulness, about counselors, and also MBSR, that is mindfulness-based stress reduction programs, with mental health workers, and so there are so many MBCT means the mindfulness based cognitive therapy. There are so many research available, and here the Dr. Kabat Singh says that the integration, the mindfulness, has its origin from Buddhism, and we can integrate the concepts into the therapeutic settings. And also he particularly mentioned the therapist who practice mindfulness should practice mindfulness techniques by themselves. So that is a requirement. This particular article, the Professor Theo Noy's article, he had done a meta-analysis on mindfulness. Actually, when I met him, we had a discussion about mindfulness with Professor Oi, and Professor Oi clearly said in his article, and also he verbally said, that when we take the idea from Buddhism, there are some missing parts. Rather, actually, the Buddhist concept of mindfulness is rather wide, and when you take the thing, it is a little bit confused, and also it's diluted according to Professor Theo Noy. So I look at the gap and I try to do something to fill up the gap. Then I select a sample of people. Of course, the practicing counselors in Sri Lanka, and to discover their experience of practicing mindfulness in their therapeutic activities. The aim and objective is to discover the lived experience of counselors who integrate the Buddhist concept of mindfulness into counseling, to understand how the counselors integrate their experience in therapeutic practices and in other counseling situations within Sri Lankan context. and also to identify whether there's a significant difference between the general mindfulness techniques. General mindfulness techniques meaning the normal, the mindfulness practices that we are doing normally, like breathing techniques and all, you know, other techniques. And is there a significant difference between BCM is Buddhist concept of mindfulness? So these are my research questions, and try to understand and gather their experiences. So methodology, of course, it's a quantitative research framework, and to get the experiences of people, we thought that the phenomenological approach is the best. And the purposive and stone-ball sampling, and 15 qualified counselors, those who practice BCM and DCM both, were selected in the Western province in Sri Lanka. And open-ended face-to-face interviews are conducted, audio recorded, and pre-scrutinizing of transcribed data to them, and data analysis, you know, using transcribing, coding, categorization, and of course the thematic analysis done. And the validation of the result, you know, with the peers. So the three themes emerge: the complexity of the phenomenon, the main ideas of the theme was theoretical foundation and the goal orientation, art of intervention, specific methods employed, and socio-cultural orientation, and the effectiveness in application, hands-on experiences, sustainability of the change. So those are the main themes and the ideas in those themes. What we realized actually when we did the research, the complexity of the phenomenon, actually this is based on the Buddhist cognitive part of it, I must say. So we found that the three theories are used by the counselors. One is the three characteristics of existence, that is in Buddhism it says the reduction and the noble eightfold path and the dependent orientation. That is what the BZM. When we look at the three characteristics of existence, it says anicca, dukkha, anatta. Those are actually the terminology that we use in the Buddhist concept. What do you mean by anicca? Anicca is, now you think of something valuable. Say your mobile phone can be fragile, breakable, you may lose it at any time, it undergoing a decaying process, which is the universal thing, that is anicca. Those things happening beyond your control. If you do not understand that, you are liable to suffer for unsatisfactoriness, that is dukkha. So you are worrying about for useless things. That is worthless, that is anatta, in simple language. If you do not understand, so you are liable to suffer. So the realization of three characteristics of existence is reduction or high vision. When you look at the other theory, special theory in Buddhism, is the Noble Eightfold Path. When you look at the first one, it is right vision, that is the understanding of the reduction. And when you look at the seventh step, which is the sequential order, if you look at the second, seventh step is mindfulness. Now the Western world has taken the mindfulness as a mechanical thing and just paying attention to the, you know, whatever you do, but without the right vision, you can't have the right mindfulness. That cognitive change has to be there. So that is the important part of this research. And when you come to DCM, it's short-term, temporary, and it's a solution, it's focused on existing problems, but the BCM is a long, long-lasting thing. Need a cognitive change is a must. Actually, I made your work easier to, I summarized the thing, and if you see a client who is suffering, maybe suffering from something, suffering from stress, suffering from cancer or anything, why you can use BCM, all the mindfulness techniques, and bring the client to a moderate level. And you can use also the BCM as well. BCM or GCM is effective. But from there onwards, if you really help the client to change, the pocket to change, right, that is the change. It Dhamma, it says, that's the name of Bhadam. And so you go, after this change, there's a long process. That is really where you apply BCM, right? That is the activity part of the Buddhist concept. So the GCM, you can say general counselling and the relaxation exercises, and BCM, general counselling plus this part, educating the theoretical foundation and help to understand the reality of the world is a must.